Development and Research in the Office of Alumni Affairs and Development, and welcome back to campus. All right, so I'm going to introduce the moderator for this afternoon's panel, Professor Curtis Dozier. Curtis Dozier has taught at Vassar in the Department of Greek and Roman Studies since 2008. In 2014, he hosted a performance of Theater of Art, which was recently covered by the New York Times on Memorial Weekend. Theater of War, which is based in New York City, performs stage readings of ancient Greek tragedies that enable veterans and civilian audiences to start conversations about the readjustment of soldiers to civilian life. Shortly thereafter, Curtis also became involved with the Vassar Veterans Posse Program, serving as a faculty mentor to Vassar Posses 1 and 3. And he will also continue to serve as a faculty mentor to next year's incoming freshman class. So please join me in welcoming Professor Curtis Dozier.
Thank you very much, Sharon, and it's great to see everyone. Welcome back to Vassar and Poughkeepsie. I'm gonna just say a couple things about the program to help you learn about that, and then I'm going to turn things over to the three veterans I have with me from the program. They're going to just say a little bit about their experience at Vassar, and then we'll open it up to your questions and have a conversation. The way the program is structured, there's a lot to the program, but one part of it is there's every incoming class of veterans has a faculty mentor assigned to them, and I was the mentor to the class that just graduated, and to two others, and what I do as a mentor is I have individual meetings with all the veterans in my group every other week, and at those meetings we do that for their freshman and sophomore year, and at those meetings we talk about really all aspects of their life, their academic life, their social life, their personal life, their career goals. It's really I get to know them very well. And my job is really to make sure that they have all the information they need and access to all the resources they need to be successful here. And then the other part of the program that I'm involved in is since the philosophy of the Posse program is that kind of non-traditional students do better in college when they are in college with a group of people like them, a posse, if you like. We meet as a group. The veterans meet as a group every week during their freshman and sophomore years to share information, to joke around, to share strategies, and just sort of keep focused on big picture issues relating to their academic and career success, whether that's declaring majors or choosing classes for the next semester or applying for internships and fellowships. You know, that's just a time for all of us to work together on those things and kind of carve out a space to make sure we're doing those even at the same time as we're keeping up with our homework and all the other things that go into being a Vassar student. And I have to say that working with the veterans has been the most rewarding work of my time at Vassar because for a lot of reasons, in large part just because of the extraordinary people you meet in the program, and you'll meet some of them in a minute, but also just as a faculty member, it's really rewarding to see the power of the education we're trying to provide here in the hands of extraordinary people like the ones who are admitted through this program. Classes, the mentoring relationships they form that are made possible by a school of this type, it's they really make the most of it, and it's just so great to see that. We're lucky to be joined by three outstanding members of the program today. I want to acknowledge before we start, though, it feels a little strange to me at Vassar College to have a panel that's all men. So I just want to say that I noticed that. And actually, part of that is because of the demographics of the armed forces. There are more men than women in our program. But I do want to say we have some amazing women on campus in the program. And we invited some of them to come today, but Isabel Castillo, who's a rising junior, she's doing research at Harvard this summer. And Nicole Ledenham, a senior psychology major, she studied abroad in Spain in the spring and isn't back in the area. Makita Johnson is a sophomore Asian studies major. She actually really wanted to do it, but had to go home for a family emergency. So we have great women in the program. And I guess I just feel I had to acknowledge that at a school with this history. So now to our panel. Here on my right is Brian Lepak. He's a rising sophomore. He's interested in economics, drama, and film. He was in the Marine Corps from 2000. That's all right. He was in the Marine Corps from 2008 to 2013 and was deployed twice to Afghanistan. He's working for the Vassar Development Office this summer, and he aspires to become a film producer. In the middle there is Fernando Braga, who is a member of the first graduating class of Posse Veterans at Vassar, just graduated. Graduated with a degree in international studies with correlates in history and Chinese. He spent a year in Iraq with the U.S. Army National Guard, and at Vassar he spent two semesters studying in China. He interned at the Council on Foreign Relations. He founded the Student World Affairs Conference of the Hudson Valley, which has become an annual event. And he will be a Catherine Davis for Peace Fellow at Middlebury this coming summer. He's currently applying for he's impressive. They're all impressive. He's currently applying for positions in the fields of foreign policy and law. And then down at the end is Patrick DeYoung. He's a rising senior political science major. He spent two deployments in Afghanistan during 5 years in the U.S. Army. He's co-founder of the Vassar Refugee Solidarity Organization. He's the student coordinator for the Collective Impact Project related to refugee solidarity, and he plans to attend law school after graduation. He's interested in immigration, civil rights, and criminal and constitutional law. So, like I said, they're each going to kind of just share a perspective on what being a Vassar has been like for them, and then we'd love to take questions from the audience. So I'll hand it over to Brian.
Hi, thank you all for coming. I just finished my first year, and I've been fortunate enough to be the first class that had a posse in each class year than before me. And so I believe my experience was a lot different. I had an amazing first year. This is the happiest I've ever been at Vassar, is being at Vassar. And I owe it a lot to the ones who came before me. I truly believe having that many veterans on campus really made me feel welcomed here. I can't imagine what it would have been like had I shown up just by myself. Having the group was really wonderful. Also with that, one of my favorite things about Vassar is the diversity among its students. By bringing veterans in and all the other students that do attend Vassar, I believe it's an environment that no two people are actually the same. We can be labeled veterans, but at this table, as you heard, none of us are the same. And I believe that's true with every student that attends Vassar. And so having that diversity, to me, really makes you the acceptance of all types of people. Without that, you're isolating yourself. And so having that environment at Vassar has made the transition really helpful for me. I'll let Fernando speak on his experience.
Yeah, thanks, Brian. The part of the first inaugural posse here at Vassar College, which was the first veterans posse program in the country. There are now veteran posse programs at Wesleyan and Dartmouth, and other schools are coming on board. And so when my cohort arrived at Vassar, there was only one other vet, Sarah, who was not part of the posse program before she graduated our freshman year. And, you know, so for me, and I'm going to speak personally, right? I'm not going to speak about my whole posse, my whole cohort. I'll tell you my experience. My experience was that it was a lot of transitions, meaning that in different ways, posse and Vassar both had to adjust to this new thing, because Vassar and posse both had been doing what they've been doing for a long time and doing it really well. And then we come along and, you know, it's like fitting us into their environment. And I would say after 4 years, it's been an amazing, a great process. It ultimately has. And I'll say enough to have you guys ask enough questions, and now you can talk about whatever, and you can ask me whatever you want. I'm an alumni, so it doesn't matter, right? So it'll be fine. But what I'm saying is I really enjoyed it. What Curtis was saying about the support to succeed, I definitely got that in spades. All those things that I did was because of all the support I had at Vassar. I could not have done that all without this tremendous help of so many advisors here and the support of friends. And you know, and I'll just say one more thing about the social environment. It was, I think because there weren't other veterans here, that was something that was also an adjustment. And I would just say one note that I think it was my second semester of sophomore year before I had friends who were traditional students. Most of my friends were veterans until like four semesters in. So like freshman fellow group, I kind of know their names, right? Just to give you an idea of the experiences. I don't know when they started doing freshman fellow groups, but if you guys were close with yours, if you had them, you know, it's really weird to be like, how could you not know their names? That I lived off campus my first year, so that was, you know, I had a little different experience, and you know, we can talk about that in the Q&A. So, Pat.
Thank you all for having us. So my experience is kind of in the middle of theirs. I'm part of the second class of veterans to arrive here at Vassar, and to be honest, I've been in love with this place since I got here. Vassar has been a really wonderful experience, and I'm very grateful to be here. I think the mentorship that we get here from our advisors and from other professors is something that both for a lot of veterans who come back and for a lot of college students traditionally isn't available in larger institutions, and that has been really central to my success here. I'd say the college really hit a home run with their choice of advisors. Curtis has been a great resource for his classes, and my own advisor, Professor Plotkin, him and I hit it off right away. He's also my major advisor in the political science department, and generally, like, I try to be in touch with him a couple times a week just to talk and have conversations. And we really were able to connect too, because before I got here, you know, I had an impression of, like, you know, small, private, elite college, and that's not the background that I come from. I'm a first-generation college student. So when I met Sid, my advisor, he also was a first-generation college student and came from kind of a working class background to, you know, get his education, get his doctorate, and now be teaching here. So for me, it was really valuable to see someone who had kind of forged that path in his life and ended up in an institution such as this to provide guidance. So that's been really, really valuable. And I think my social experience has been a little bit different than Fernando's. I was kind of thrown into the fire when I got here. I moved into Lathrop House my freshman year and was the only veteran living there. And the entirety of the rest of my cohort was in Noise House. So I was kind of across campus from everyone else and kind of forced to be social and become friends with a lot of traditional students. So it was a really good experience because I ended up making a lot of friends and serving on house team and being able to kind of give back to the Vassar community. So overall, it's been so far a great experience and I'm looking forward to my senior year.
Thanks, guys. That's actually what it's like to be here. So I'd like to open it up to the audience to, you know, if there's anything you'd like to hear about from them or anything they've said that they'd love to take your questions. What we'll do is I'll call on you and then I'm going to kind of restate the question just so everyone can hear it and then they can answer as they like. So here, please.
What made each one of you choose Vassar?
She's wondering why.
How did you get into the program?
Why did they choose Vassar and how did they get into the program?
So I just want to answer first because it'll make chronological sense.
Yeah.
So I first heard about it through a friend of mine who was still in my unit, the unit that I had left in New York City in the National Guard, and he said, "Let's go to the this introductory meeting." He never showed. I'm here, there was no choice of Vassar College at that point. There was a choice for me whether to go to this program, Posse Veterans Program at Vassar, or not go to college at all. So that was the choice. There were no other schools, and that was the choice for me.
Whenever I answer this question, because it's pretty common, I always like to say that kind of Vassar chose me. I didn't choose Vassar. When I got out of the Army, I had a year between the Army and enrolling at Vassar, and I was enrolled in a program called Veterans Upward Bound at the University of Pennsylvania. It's basically a prep program to help you transition from military life to higher academic, academics. And the program director at the time knew that I was going to be applying for schools for the fall term and said, "Hey, you know, there's this scholarship." She didn't mention it was Vassar specific, just that it was a scholarship for veterans. And she's like, "You should apply for it. It's late in the cycle and you probably won't get it, but it'll be good interview experience if you're looking at institutions of that caliber." So I applied, and about the third or fourth interview in, they said, "Hey, so we're actually only looking for students for two schools, Vassar or Wesleyan, so what's your preference?"
Oh.
And I said, "I'd rather go to Vassar because I want to live in New York and not Connecticut." So here I am.
I was attending school at George Mason University in Northern Virginia, and George Mason does it a little different. I had to choose my major before attending college, and so I went with finance. And through the Veterans Affairs Office, I was made aware of the Posse program, and it was between Vassar, Wesleyan, and Dartmouth, and it was very appealing to me. So I went through the application process. The reason I decided to leave George Mason was because I wasn't happy with the education I was receiving. It was very technical. I had to choose my major, and then my curriculum was picked for me. And there wasn't flexibility amongst taking other courses in other departments. And so when I did my research between the three colleges, the Vassar, Wesleyan, and Dartmouth, Vassar was my first pick. I fell in love with it right away, with the flexibility in the curriculum, all the different organizations that are on campus. I knew it was the school for me. And fortunately, I ended up here, so.
Fernando, would you mind elaborating, though, because, you know, Brian's experience shows that it's not exactly right to say it was the choice between coming to Vassar or not going to college. I mean, you had, like, why, so you weren't choosing between programs in the Posse program, but you know, was there anything about a school like Vassar that interested you?
Yeah, no, thank you, because as people were talking, I realized I left that out. So the choice, I was at the time that Vassar, or that the Posse program was a choice for me, in my fifth year being a track worker in the New York City Transit Authority. Is what it sounds like. I was working nights, taking apart and putting back together track in New York City subway. I loved it. It was great. Playing with Legos, like underground in the subway. It was it was like a dream. It was like, it was the best thing. I was like, I'm gonna do 20 years. Like, why would I ever leave this? Is what I thought. I heard about it from my friend, and I was like, no, immediately. I'm not going to some. And what's Vassar anyway? I never heard of this place. I didn't. I had never. It wasn't part of my life. And so my then wife at the time, she said, well, why not just look at it more? And I did. I spent some time on the Vassar website, and I came back to her, and I was like, okay, now I'm sure I definitely don't want to go. It's a bunch of 18 and 22-year-olds, and, you know, it's just, I don't want to be in that environment. It's, you know, I'm in my late 20s at this point, and, I'm settled, and I have a plan. Why throw that away? And she's like, okay, fine, but why would you do it? And so I was just like, oh, yeah, I'll just tell you why I would do it. So 3 hours later, after I told her, I spent all this time watching YouTube videos about watching Vassar students talk about their classes, and I just like not only regurgitated, but was connecting to like all these different things people were talking about. These, you know, very contemporary courses, the intellectual environment, and I went on forever like I'm doing now. She was like, so you don't want to do it, huh? And I was like, okay, you've made your point. And I went to the interview.
let me just mention one thing also that came up, I think, in Pat's comment, is that the scholars in the veterans program are selected through a different process, and frankly a more demanding process than our traditional students. The foundation and Vassar, they look at test scores and they look at GPAs, and in the case of many of these college courses before here, and those traditional markers, but there also is a series of interviews with the foundation. There's a series of group activities that they observe applicants interacting with each other. There's one-on-one interviews, there's group interviews. It's a multi-day process, a multi-hour process. And as part of my training for a mentor, I went through some of the activities they do. And I just remember thinking, like, if I had to do these things when I was applying to college, there's no way I would have gotten into the schools that I got into. So you know, it's a really interesting and different way of choosing people, and that's why we get such interesting people. Okay, there was a hand up here in the front for the first question. That may look like
I was just wondering whether you and the other mentors are veterans or not.
I don't think we haven't had a mentor who was a veteran. The question was, are any of the mentors veterans? I'm not a veteran, and I don't think any of the veterans we've had, the mentors we've had, are veterans. There aren't that many veterans on the faculty. I think actually we may have our first one right now, at least of the current generation. I'm sure there were other veterans in the past. And that, of course, I mean, that may be a limitation of the program, although I think we do as well as we can, but it points to the need for programs like this, because there's such a divide between the veteran world and the world of elite colleges, and especially small liberal arts colleges, that this program is really addressing that divide and bringing people into my life as a faculty member that I never would have met, and bringing me into their lives too.
Thanks. So guys, I want to thank you for your service, first of all. And I'm really surprised that a Marine was able to string together such a coherent sentence, so bravo. I have an introduction, then I have a question. So my name is Bruce Mendelson. Bruce Mendelson. Yeah. Class of 1990, I'm a Persian Gulf War veteran.
But not a Marine.
Not a Marine. I did ROTC here at Vassar over through Marist. So the question I have for you guys is, Vassar focuses a great deal on reading, right? And the military does as well. Mostly FMs. What one book has each of you gentleman read that has informed your service to our country?
Just for the tape, the question is, what book have they read that...
I have one. Shoot straight to the top of my head because it was one of the two things that made me decide to pursue law school. And so the book is Presidential War Power by constitutional scholar Louis Fisher. And when I, and it's all about war. It's all about war from the point of view of the Constitution. And I could not understand how those two things went together, the Constitution and war, much less my experience. And when I read that book in Sidney Plotkin's class, I was like, not only did I get my experience more, not only did I understand, you know, not only swearing oath to the Constitution, but like playing a role in Iraq and doing what I did there, I understood what the role of the United States Constitution was in our foreign policy. And I was like, I want to do something related to this in a deep way. So, yeah.
I didn't say
that. Yeah,
I'm trying to think.
Same, I don't have anything at this time.
Let me while they think about that, let me take another question because they'll come up with it as the time goes. Our phone, please.
I'm interested in you mentioned the divide on the campus between the veterans and the regular student body. What is the nature of your interaction with the students? What happens when you are in class or when you are walking out of class? Do you tend to stick together? We all stay with our friends. But do students, traditional students, make an effort to get to know you? How do those dynamics work?
The question is to describe the interaction, their interactions with.
Yeah, so like as I mentioned before, I kind of got put in my own building my first week here, so I'll tell kind of an anecdote from that. I was nervous when I first got here about interacting with students because I had served with people of all ages in the Army, and you don't, in the Army, sort people by age group. So, you know, you might have a guy in the barracks sleeping under you who's 17 and a guy in the bunk next to you's 45. You never know. So I wasn't that nervous about the age difference, but you know, I didn't know how people were going to perceive me and my service and how they would feel about that. So when I was moving in to Lathrop House, the first night I was there after orientation, I was kind of in my room by myself unpacking boxes, and two students knocked at the door and said, "Hey," and introduced themselves and said, "Hey, are you one of the veterans?" And I said, "Yeah," and we started talking and said, "Listen, we know you're kind of in the building by yourself. Do you want to come to a party and see what Vassar is like?" It was the night of the international orientation party, so I ended up going with them and met a lot of people who became really close friends of mine who I actually ended up sharing a TA with last year. So I lived in a TA with four traditional students last year. So. I feel like my experience has been one of pretty early integration to campus life, so it's been good.
I can talk, yeah. When I first showed up, I stuck closely with my posse, with the veterans, and as time went on, I was introduced to some of Pat's close friends, which helped with my transition in social life. As far as the traditional students approaching me or talking about anything about my service, it's not really the key focus on our conversation. They don't approach me because I'm a veteran. They approach me just because I'm another student, and they treat me as such. I don't get special treatment. We're all equals, kind of, and so it's nice to have that. I don't think we get isolated because of it. There, if anything, people are more interested. But besides that, yeah.
Just because I know I mentioned it earlier, and that my first experience getting to know some of the traditional students in my freshman year was at what is an annual event called the Posse Plus Retreat. It is something that the Vassar hosts as part of our program, the Veterans Posse Program. We discuss many issues, but that was the first weekend as a freshman, having being off campus, living with a family off campus, where I spent 48 hours with other students. And I, before that, did not understand why people I saw in class, having come from Hunter College before, Communer College, where if you had a class with someone, you went deep with them. Like, that was, those were your people. It was like, we have a class together, you know, we have a connection. It was really strong. So I had a class with people here at Vassar, and I'd say hello, expecting like to get into a conversation, and they just sort of like, and I would be like, you know, I had these false ideas in my head that it was my age. Found out that wasn't true later, but at PPR was when I realized that, I guess, like what Pat and Brian were saying, like the lives of Vassar students are very much bound up in what you do totally outside of class, you know, in the dorms, at the D's, elsewhere, and doing other things. And that was something that, as a off-campus veteran in the first year, something that I had to learn.
If I could, yeah, a little bit more on my experience. So I did come from George Mason University, which is normally a commuter school. It has 30,000 students, and because it's a commuter school and there's not really residential life, it was really tough to make friends there. And I think within the first week of coming to Vassar and living on campus and being involved with all the students, I knew more people at Vassar than I ever did in the 2 years at George Mason.
For me, just to say, that's another part of the program where every year the veterans and the goal is 100 other people from around the campus community go off campus for a weekend and spend the weekend in facilitated workshops relating usually to some sort of hot social issue in contemporary culture, all part of the program's goal to create opportunities for conversations about serious topics between people who wouldn't normally encounter each other. You had a hand up?
I did.
Yeah, please, go ahead.
So did the college say to the current students any directions, any ideas for how they should or they could approach these extraordinary men? I mean, did you give them any instruction, orientation towards their arriving on campus?
Well, that was, if they did that, it was before I was involved in the program. So I think all I can do is pass it off and say, did you feel that the college gave the students any guidance on or any preparation for the arrival of veterans on campus?
Thankfully, no. There was absolutely none. And the men and women, there were three women in our 11 posse, in our first posse, and thankfully there was no, other than that the program existed, that we were part of freshmen, the freshman class, there was nothing else, which I love. I would not want any kind of guidance on discussing how to interact with us at all. And it was,
Honestly, I don't think the college would have to. I mean, most of the students who are admitted here are really bright, intelligent, and polite people, and don't approach us in a way that would, you know, suggest anything else. I think that the caliber of student here at Vassar is such that you wouldn't need to tell them how to, you know, interact with us, because most people have treated me the same way they would treat anyone else, and that's always been my experience with students at Vassar.
Thank you.
Please, in green now.
Yeah, I was wondering why you three joined the armed forces in the first place.
Yeah.
And a follow-up, why haven't your contemporaries joined the armed forces?
Why did they join the armed forces in the first place, and why haven't their contemporaries joined the armed forces? You mean why?
And most U.S. citizens do not. When I was in school, Everyone was either a veteran or was going to become one.
Take this, I guess, a little bit. So, how many people in here are veterans? Okay, yeah, that's probably more than we would have in a Vassar class, contemporarily. But for myself, didn't join the military right out of high school. I joined when I was 22. I actually went to college at Rutgers for 3 years before joining the Army. I joined in 2007 after 3 years of public university, working two jobs at night, and getting my financial aid slashed every year by the state of New Jersey. So for me, it was a combination of, I can't afford this, I don't know what I'm doing, and I'm working dead-end jobs. And my grandfather served in the Army in the Second World War, and my other grandfather served in the Navy during Korea. And I had kind of been brought up in my family with a sense of public service as being something that a man and an adult should always be doing in some sense in his life. So I thought, you know, if college is not working out, I should join the Army. And it worked out for my grandfathers, and they came home from the service and built really good lives for themselves. So I made that decision, and it was a good one. It got me here, and I'm very proud to be here. But for a lot of students here and a lot of students in my generation, I don't think that there's the same level of pressing need for military service that there was in prior generations. The United States doesn't face, well, arguably, the United States doesn't face existential threats the way it did during the Second World War or the Cold War, where we had, you know, adversaries kind of arrayed that would threaten the existence of our country. There are threats to the country today, and there always will be, but I think it's debatable whether those threats are existential or whether they are more more or less serious than that. So I think that motivates a lot of people differently in the current generation. And I think for a place like Vassar, to be honest, I mean, World War II is an exception in American history. Traditionally, people who join the military come from working class and lower middle class backgrounds, and most Vassar students don't. So it's, I think that sense of urgency and that sense of that as a viable option in your life is a lot different for students in the socioeconomic backgrounds that come to Vassar.
I'm originally from Brazil, and my in Brazil, conscription is it's mandatory for men, and that was always in my life because of that we weren't certain whether we would be able to stay in the U.S. as a youth. So the idea of me going to the military was there since I was as a kid. When I joined after straight out of high school was very directly to pay for school. My mother had sort of, you know, taken care of me, and I wanted to start as early as possible to say I'm going to start off independently, and so that she wouldn't have to pay for school, and that was that simple. Yeah.
I joined the military for similar reasons. Growing up, I knew that college wouldn't really be an option. I wasn't willing to go in debt myself for it. For different reasons, I needed a place to live, so I joined the service. As far as
people your age in general,
yeah,
not joining, why?
Yeah, I feel like it's not so much of a numbers game anymore with the technologies we have now. It's a different numbers thing, and maybe like who has more nukes, but like, I feel like with the technology we have now, we don't need as many service members, and if there's an opportunity to attend Vassar or to join the military, I think 9 out of 10 go to Vassar.
Yes,
yeah.
In blue there.
Okay, I was wondering how many people apply to the Posse program each year, from which the now, I guess it's 33 times 10 are selected?
The question is how many people apply to the Posse program every year? And I don't know the answer to that.
So the first cohort was 250 out of the 10 that were selected.
Wow.
It grows every year. That was that was a new program that not a lot of people knew about when they had 250 applicants for 10 spots.
Yeah, so I believe it's grown every year somewhat exponentially. And I know they told you guys 250. I think they told us around 500 or 600 applied for the 20 slots. And I'm not really sure where it's at with you.
This was my first year. And by our time, I think it had just hit over 1,000. It was the first year over 1,000, and that's still growing.
Cool. I am a former Posse mentor from Carleton College, so I'm very, very happy to have the opportunity to meet. And my question just has been raised by the issue we're just talking about. It's my understanding that people, non-military students, often are nominated. In other words, there isn't necessarily an application process, but they don't apply blind. Is this a different process for veterans?
So the question is, she's comparing the Posse Foundation has been sending kind of non-traditional groups of students to elite colleges for more than 25 years. And the question is comparing the process for selecting those non-veteran Posse members to the selection of the veteran Posse members. They do take nominations, but especially since the program is new, it's more appropriate to compare this program to the first 3 years of the traditional Posse program. So they do take nominations and they take those seriously, but a lot of the work that the foundation does is going out to military bases and community colleges with large veteran populations and trying to spread the word of the program. Posse does a lot of work on recruiting. That said, I have met at different Posse events, certain registrars or veteran services advisors at certain schools are kind of getting clued in and are starting to nominate, and it's really promising to see that kind of momentum growing around that nomination process. Do you guys want to say anything about that?
I did it. The program director of the Veterans Upper Bound program at UPenn nominated me. But I think, like Curtis said, it's still a pilot program, so they kind of have to get the numbers where they can.
Yeah, over here, please.
Vassar did the first Posse Veterans program. Now there are three, Dartmouth, Wesleyan, and Vassar.
What
movement is afoot to expand that?
The question
is, how is that working?
We've grown, the nationally there are now three schools that have veteran Posse program, and the question is, how is that going to expand? Which I think is really a question for the foundation, probably. But but I welcome your thoughts about that or observations.
From my understanding, is they want to be very selective with the colleges that they accept, and they want at least 10 universities, and they want it to be the elite colleges.
Yeah, I know they're looking to expand to 10, and from what I understand, they really want to keep the model to elite liberal arts colleges for the veterans program. I don't believe they're looking to expand to large universities. They want to keep it at schools that are very similar to Vassar in terms of selectivity and size.
Yeah, next to her.
One of the goals generally of diversifying a student body is not just to expand opportunity and be socially just, but also to help enrich the environment and the perspective for the traditional students from maybe more traditional upper middle class backgrounds, for example. And I was wondering, you all have at least served in combat zones, and thank you for that. You probably, perhaps have also seen combat. I know that in my Vassar education, majoring in English and taking other liberal arts courses, there were a lot of things that we read that had to do with war and conflict, some of the classics, for example. And I wonder if you all feel that you bring something to those classes from your perspective that the students who have not served wouldn't bring.
The question is, what do they think they bring to the classroom and the campus different from our traditional students?
Yeah, I think you mentioned specific like readings, the idea of reading texts that having to do with war, and I think those I think as a freshman taking a class of Maria Hearn in 1945, and I went on with her to the international studies trip to Europe, where we were looking at Europe in the Age of War, looking at war memorials in Europe. And I would say that, and I say this, it's one thing having been in class, but she mentioned this at our ceremony, and our other professors did, that, you know, I felt like in that class, if just something that I was able to clearly just say that this is how the military works, it was an obvious question, as opposed to sort of having these musings about, like, you know, how does the chain of command work, or like, we're at a bunker, you know, it's like, well, how did they, you know, what was it like? And it's like, we weren't there, obviously, and we can't say that, but we can, from our military training, there's some really simple things we can point out that might not be obvious to traditional students. So professors have mentioned to me as a graduate over the, looking back over the 4 years, that they've been like, this has been extraordinarily enriching in the ways that I think you're pointing out.
Great, thank you.
An example that comes to mind for me is just in my international human rights course, we were talking, discussing Hillary Clinton's proposed no-fly zone over Syria. And the professors, knowledgeable of the military, but I think to the students, it was effective to have me there to kind of reiterate the difficulties of enforcing a no-fly zone. A professor can say it, but when you have experience controlling no-fly zones, you're able to provide your personal experience and go in depth on that topic. Yeah,
I think something that, especially when we're reading in a lot of my politics classes, and especially certain history classes, a lot of the context we can help provide is like the why. I think when you read about war in textbooks, you read either about, you know, big battles or acts of violence, and most of war, if you're experiencing it, is those things, but is also a lot of other things. I think the quote is that, you know, amateurs do tactics and professionals do logistics, and most of war revolves around logistics, and people don't realize that. So when people make statements like, oh, well, we should just do a no-fly zone, that's a solution, or we should intervene here, or why is it taking us so long to get out of Afghanistan or Iraq, I think us having that experience being at these places and saying, well, it's not just us landing and walking around with our guns, like there's whole structures that are built and then have to be unbuilt or moved to make these things happen. And when you read about them in the book, you don't read about that behind the scenes work. You just read about the action, and it's looked at as like a singular event, and then it ends. And war is not a singular event. War is a series of structures that have to be built and unbuilt and rebuilt. And I don't think a lot of students understand that. And most people don't understand that unless you've seen it yourself. So.
The question was focused on kind of what's it like to talk about war in the classroom with Vassar students who have no experience of it, and there were great answers. But, and that definitely is a way that the veterans enrich our experience a lot. But I've also observed that there are things that I think are related to being a veteran that aren't related to war and conflict, that they teach the students about. And these are things like, I've observed that the veterans are more willing to ask questions that no one else will ask. And that's so valuable in the classroom. It's like precious. A lot of them have gotten to be really good at handling adversity. And they can kind of model that for the students in a way. I mean, I think for a lot of them, the adversities here are kind of small compared to some others that they've seen. And they can show what it's like to sort of be challenged and rise to it. Not every single one of them, but a lot of them have certain kinds of leadership and organizational skills they learned in the military. I've got this one veteran in one of my groups who, whenever his classes have group work, it's like everyone wants to be in his group. Because they just know it's going to get done, you know, with him there. And then the biggest thing that I think you guys actually don't get enough credit for is that almost all of them know why they're here, in a way that a lot of our students who are perfectly qualified to be here, but sort of grew up knowing they were going to go to college and just haven't had to reflect on it that much. They can kind of get lost here or wander a little, and that's not always a bad thing. But you know, I really admire how the veterans kind of chose to be here, and you know, had to like actively come here in a way, and that actually reverberates through their work with the students in a lot of very productive ways. Please hear it in a second.
My question has absolutely nothing to do with Vassar. I would like to know how, after fighting overseas, you had a readjustment problem coming back to the States.
Good question.
She's wondering, what was it like to, how, what was the readjustment like coming back to the United States after being deployed?
Yeah, so my particular experience was that I found it, one challenge I found was that, you know, I sort of had a plan about what I wanted to do in school and in life and my friends. Once I got back from the year, and to my surprise, everything had changed. Like, the world didn't stop. You know, that, I'm saying that facetiously. It wasn't in, and so that was an adjustment. That was one of many adjustments that I had to make in coming back from deployment. And, you know, I don't think, and I wanna say that there isn't really a one kind of experience. I feel like a lot of veterans excel. Some veterans have trouble, and there's no one experience that you can really say, like, you know, this is what vets go through after coming back. I don't think that really exists. Everyone has their own journey, just like college. You can't say, oh, you went to college too? I know what that was like, right? No, everyone has a different journey. I think that's like what deployment is like. Everyone has their own path, and so, you know, that was one of the challenges I had to find.
I think for myself, my last deployment was in 2013, and then 2 months after getting back, I was being honorably discharged from the Marine Corps. So I went from being deployed, and everything I did was not for myself, but for the person next to you. And then I left, and it was really different because you weren't surrounded by the people that you worked with. It was hard to kind of like dig inside yourself and kind of like motivate yourself to do things for yourself, because the whole time you were doing things different for the person next to you.
I feel like in some ways I'm still transitioning. I got out of the military in 2013, and as I mentioned before, I had about a year between my discharge and enrolling at Vassar. And but while I was discharging, I, you know, kind of checked all the boxes, enrolled myself in a college prep program, and got ready to move home to Philadelphia. And when I got back, things had changed, but a lot of things hadn't. A lot of my friends were doing a lot of the same things that they had been doing when I left, that I was looking to get away from when I left. So that year for me was really valuable. I'm glad I had a year between the Army and Vassar, because they're very different environments. And I ended up working, you know, waiting tables and bartending. And I would say waiting tables with people is a lot different than being an infantry sergeant in a combat zone, because you deal with a lot of crap from people in both, but you're not really allowed to yell back when you're waiting tables. So I got to kind of tone down a lot of my rougher qualities in that environment before I got here, which I think was really valuable.
All right, yeah, please.
This question is addressed to the gentleman in the middle. It seemed to me when you gave your resume, that you became interested in peace studies and peace things. And I'm curious how that journey evolved for you. Was it what you studied here? Was it your experiences in the service or foundation?
No. The question is, how did Fernando come to be interested in peace?
Yeah, in Iraq. My experience, I would say, was on the less saw less combat than most, and I was very fortunate being in Iraq to have that experience. But there was one instance where there was a situation that could have been deadly from our point of view, us initiating the deadly violence, and I felt at the moment that it wasn't proper to do so at that moment. The threat wasn't the proper threat, and I was able to intervene and with my sergeant and say, these are the reasons why I don't think we should deal with them in this way, and these are the reasons why I think we should, you know, just leave them be and work on, you know, dealing with these other people. And he relented. It worked, and I was like, I made a difference. And I say that after over maybe 15 years later now. This was 2000. It wasn't almost 15. It was 2004. But that was that's something I didn't realize for many years, that influenced me in the way that it did. And so by the time I got to Vassar, I wanted to be able to take that sort of moment and knowing sort of the destruction that war brings overall, and to try to do what I could to prevent any wars that weren't in our interest and weren't in our self-defense, and say, you know, what is it that we can do to pursue our interests, and, you know, when I think avoiding war, especially war with China, is one of those interests. So that's.
In the very back.
I was just wondering what, you know, an unexpected good thing about being ambassador, maybe an unexpected challenge about being ambassador.
The question is, what's an unexpected good thing about being ambassador, and what's an unexpected challenge?
So, an unexpected good thing that I had my first year at Vassar, the summer after my freshman year, I studied abroad in China, and I never thought I would be going to China in my life, and especially not like 2 years after I got out of the army. So that was a really amazing trip, and the unexpected challenge was having to learn Chinese on that trip.
I think I always have high expectations, and Vassar has met all of them. So my unexpected good, I can't really think of one. It's lived up to the hype that I read about. The unexpected challenge has been kind of, I feel as coming back to school that the classes are just filled with brilliant students, and I feel like I'm trying to keep up with them. You know, I feel like it's really hard work, and that's kind of what inspired me to instead of pursue what I'm good at, to pursue my passions when studying, because I feel like I'm always gonna be not better than someone else, so I might as well try to be the best at what I like.
The unexpected event or positive was the extent to which I finally, after becoming friends and good friends with traditional students, how deep those relationships were and how meaningful they become, because I didn't expect that. And I think similar to Brian's experience, I found academically passions that my Chinese was not what I thought it was when I arrived in China. It's like, I know some Chinese, and it's like, oh no, I don't. But here I am. So that's my summer fellowship, will be in studying more Chinese. So it's that I didn't expect to be able to do that, and I have been, and it's been great. Yeah.
To all of our veterans, and thanks to you for your veterans.
Language Institute. And our students have been able to use but we've had, I've had my colleagues had one do French in Middlebury, very
Middlebury, where you live, is doing something good for Vassar.
I had all.
Are you done?
Yeah, so it was for me, I had a few years transitioning.
It makes me proud to be here.
I
think really
President Hill's try to make
really saw that. You know, that a school like this with a history like this, you know, looking for who's not getting access to this education.
Part of it had to do with my first management experience.
This was right on target.
I don't know if I got all the things right at the time.
Very technical skills. A few months ago, the Frank Rooney piece,
when I got out, I thought,
we're just so far ahead of anyone else. Columbia has a lot of
veterans.
You know, it's sort of like Harvard has one. Princeton won't even tell you
why they have it.
That's right. You know, like, that's just, that's awesome.
I'm your class assistant. Yeah, when I got the email, I did the math, and I was like, hey, it's going to be a lot. Like, if she shows up or not, I have to have a class assistant.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm glad you made it.
Yeah. Are you our senior Marine alumni?
Yeah, she is. That was
the yes. Oh, okay, yeah. Especially around the time of the first class meeting. The college was remembering it. And there was I think, I don't know if it was an exhibition in the library, but that history was sort of brought out. You know, these aren't the first veterans. And for a lot of us, yeah, that was to realize, oh, there were actually men who graduated from Vassar before 1969. It was very interesting.
Join the Navy.
Join, and you ain't a rascal.
Hey,
the rules got stricter.